Good evening. To provide for the safety of those attending this meeting, please listen to the following instructions in case of an emergency. First, please take a moment to note where your exits are. If an emergency arises that prompts us to evacuate, please exit this room in a quick and orderly manner through one of the two doors to your right, and then proceed to the nearest stairwell, directions to which are indicated by the exit sign. Once you exit the building, we ask that you safely cross Granville Street, which is the street that runs beside our building, to our parking lot to be safely away from the building. Our staff will provide additional direction and assistance. In the case of a tornado warning, we ask that you exit this room into the hallway, where we will all remain until it is safe to exit. In the event of an active shooter in the building, if there is an accessible escape path, please run and try to evacuate the premises. If you can't evacuate, please find a place to hide where you are less likely to be found and lock any doors that you can. And as a last resort, and only if your life is in imminent danger, please fight. Our staff will provide additional direction and assistance on what to do. Thank you for your attention.
Father, we thank you for another day. Thank you for the fourth month of the year. And as time goes by so quickly, we ask that you would keep our minds and our hearts in perfect peace, that we might do the things and make decisions that will make our county a better place in which to live. Through Christ our Lord, we do pray. Amen.
You received in your general guidance the minutes of previous meeting. No additions or corrections. Is there a motion? Second. Questions? All in favor, let it be known by vote by aye.
Aye.
All opposed? In a non-amendment, so approved. At this time, a public hearing is called for order to receive citizen comments and questions relative to the proposed unified development order text amendment for the stormwater ordinance. The public hearing is now called to order. Would you please read the public notice, Mr. Peters?
Yes, sir. Public notice is hereby given that a public hearing will be held by the Board of Commissioners of Edgecombe County on Monday, April 3rd, 2023, at 7 p.m. in the Jonathan Felton Commissioner's Room, second floor, County Administrative Building, 201 St. Andrew Street, Harborough, North Carolina, to amend the Unified Development Ordinance and to adopt the county's draft local program to implement our Unified Stormwater Rules. Copies of the proposed amendments are available for public inspection during business hours at 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. in the County Planning Office, Room 205, County Administrative Building, 201 St. Andrew Street, Harbor, North Carolina. All parties of interest and all interested residents are invited and urged to be present and make their views known. This is the 22nd day of March, 2023, by order of the Board of Commissioners of Edgecombe County, signed by Francie Mungo, clerk to the board.
Chairman, any comment?
Mr. Chairman, we have with us tonight Mr. Chad Meadows with Code Right Planners, excuse me, who's going to walk you through the proposed changes. I will note that if you will refer to the copy that was left at your place tonight, there were some changes that have been made to the one that was sent in your agenda packet. Also note that we have Ms. Tina Braswell, our planning director, here tonight. If you have any other questions, but invite Mr. Meadows.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Chair, members. I'm Chad Meadows, Program
Wright. My pleasure to be back before you tonight. And I have a very short presentation. You guys have a lot of stuff on your agenda this evening. And these UDO changes are fairly brief, so we'll be able to handle these in short order. With that, I'll go ahead and get started. This is our second amendment to the UDO. As you guys recall, we adopted this ordinance. You adopted this ordinance in November of 2021. I'm hoping that you received a set of UDO pages with the changes noted in track changes format. The planning board considered this round of amendments to your UDO on two separate days, on the 20th of February of this year, and then again on the 28th. There was a little bit of discussion about the shared driveways portion, section 613B, and I'm going to talk to you about that in a moment. So ultimately, the planning board has recommended approval of these text amendments after their review. So these have been vetted and approved to the planning board. Four basic revisions for us, the first being relocation of the stormwater standards to the county code ordinances. The Tar Pamela Code River rules changed after November 1st of 2021, and it became necessary for the county to revise its regulations in working with the consultant who's actually going to be assisting you not only with the drafting of those standards, but also the implementation of your program. The feeling among staff, other consultants, myself, that it was just simpler to pull the stormwater standards out of the UDO and return them to the county code of ordinances. And so that's what this first round of changes does, simply removes the stormwater standards from the UDO in favor of relocating them in their entirety to the county code. And so more on that in a moment. We'll have some clarifications about the shared driveways issue, the item that the planning board considered twice in February. I'm going to talk very quickly about some changes to the flat certificates that relate to the health department and how they get involved with review and consideration of on-site wastewater. And then a minor change to a certain use type of event venues. So, relocating the stormwater to the county code. Essentially, what we're suggesting be done is that the stormwater permit procedure be removed, the stormwater standards in Chapter 6 be removed, we delete the terms in the UDO that deal with stormwater, and then there's a series of short references or statements in 10 different locations in the UDO. So just consistently pulling stormwater out of the UDO and making reference instead to the county code of ordinances. Shared driveways are just that, shared driveways that are permitted to serve up to four individual single-family detached homes or two family dwelling lots. So four units, either single-family detached or two duplexes. Okay, so that's what a shared driveway is. And this is included in recognition of the fact that there are some kinds of subdivisions that the General Assembly insists we permit that are not required to have public streets. And therefore, we needed this shared driveway mechanism to allow these kinds of driveways to happen without being either public or private streets. And so we drafted this. This was included in the original UDO that was adopted in November of 21. Since then, there's been some discussion with staff and applicants, and the planning board has made a suggestion or a decision that the driveway easement, this shared driveway, needs to be within an access easement that's platted and recorded. It's currently 25 feet wide. That was felt to be too narrow, and that they suggested a width of 50 feet, which makes some sense. Why would it make some sense? Because ultimately, if it can serve up to four lots, right, then it can still be a shared driveway. At five lots, it needs to be converted to a street, okay? Private street needs to be 50 feet wide. So this easement is set up, it's pre-planning for that driveway to turn into a street someday if that should ever need to happen. So in their wisdom, that is their suggestion, and we agree with it, it makes sense, and that's what's been included. included in the packet, increasing the shared driveway access easement to 50 feet wide. We are also suggesting a 25-foot wide setback from the edge of the easement, regardless of where it might be located, whether it's on your property or your neighbor's property. That's done also sort of in recognition of the fact that this might one day become a street, and it's important for your home to set back from that street. So that is the provision that's included here. We've made another reference to this in the generally applicable dimensional standards portion of the ordinance. So that's the shared driveways material. Just widening the easement and adding the setback provision. One other aspect is the timing of recording, recordation of these access easements as part of the planning process. There was an issue that we had where applicants were being required to record these access easements before the blasts were being recorded, and that was a problem, so we just made this minor shift in timing. That's it on the shared driveway side. Changes to plat certificates. So in some instances in the county, a new home might have on-site wastewater. In the past, the county has called upon the health department to certify that this lot is indeed capable of accommodating an on-site wastewater system, and that that on-site wastewater system has been installed and is operational in accordance with county health department standards. Okay? There are plat certificates to that effect. A plat certificate is basically boilerplate text that's entered onto the face of the plat and is signed by somebody from the health department that this is indeed the case. Okay? We have come to find out that the health department will no longer, does not believe that it is authorized in signing those plats or those statements on plats, and will not be signing those statements on plats going forward. And so, we have, in effect, removed those two plat certificates for the health department to execute. We have also made some adjustments to the county's, the planning department's plat certificates that say, while this plat may be approved from a planning perspective, this approval from planning does not necessarily mean that you have approval from the health department. So we've protected the planning staff, we've protected this body, while at the same time recognizing that the health department has their own process for review and consideration of on-site wastewater systems on lots in the county, and that they'll be responsible for implementing those, but it's not part of our platting process anymore, and we're not including that in our plat certificates.
What was the issue here?
As far as I know, they felt that they didn't have the legal authority to execute these plat certificates. And I'm frankly not sure why, but that was their stance, which is their prerogative.
Ms. Peters, you've been in the moment.
Yes, sir. Mr. Hanson, we have some from the state telling them that they no longer have to do it.
They do it, but not as a part of signing the plat. So that plat can be approved and recorded, but they still have to then put in a permit, environmental health, and the inspection done on site, and the permit approved.
So moves us from not doing.
That's right. Well, I haven't looked at it closely, but I would say that, otherwise it could hold up the process of approving and recording a plan.
This is really a formality, and it's just one that was incorporated in your prior ordinance. We carried it forward as part of the new UDO, and sort of the world has moved on. They're still doing it, but they're not doing it as part of the plat certificate process. So we're sort of catching our language up with current practice. But thank you for the question. Good question. Event venues. These are use types that are focused on hosting events, weddings, and other kinds of corporate events, whatever. They're use types that this is what they do. And what we're suggesting is the inclusion of a requirement for large indoor-only event venues that are proposed within the AR30 zoning district to undergo the special use permit process. So there's an extra level of scrutiny for these indoor-only facilities that are large in size, 5,000 square feet large or larger. Smaller indoor facilities and or outdoor facilities are still permitted by right, but we wanted this extra level of scrutiny for these event venues that are indoor-only venues and AR. Why do we want that? So AR is an agricultural residential district. It's a quiet district. While there is farming that takes place, one of the things that you don't see is a lot of heavy-duty commercial activity, the kind that you would see in an event venue, one that has events happening on Saturday nights, Sunday nights, any night of the week that could, you know, extend into 12, 1 in the morning. It was felt that some additional scrutiny on compatibility was an important part of allowing these larger venues. The smaller ones can still come in and be permitted by right subject to the standards in the UDO, but these larger ones, the ones that are capable of accommodating, you know, 70 people, 100 people, 200 people, that there be some compatibility review as part of that application. And so that's why that's been suggested. And lastly, just a few minor typographical repairs that were made, perimeter buffers and the change on site plan. So that's really the gist of my presentation. If unless you have questions, it would be appropriate for you to continue with your public hearing. I will mention, I've talked about the UDO changes. There are also a set of county code ordinance changes. Remember the stormwater stuff that we were picking up out of UDO and placing into the county code of ordinances. You received copies of this, I think, at your last meeting, and tonight you're being called upon to go ahead and adopt those stormwater provisions for your county code of ordinances. And so Will Larson, the consultant who's involved in that, is here if you have questions about the stormwater provisions in the county code. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions you have.
So if we adopt this, we're removing these from the UDOs.
Correct.
And putting them into the ordinances, is that what we're doing?
That's correct. You're absolutely right. You are putting them in your county code of ordinances.
Any questions for Mr. Correa?
What changed between those board meetings where there was two dissenting votes on the shared drive?
Great question. What changed was the width of the street going from a 25 foot wide easement to a 50 foot wide easement. As originally proposed, I suggested 25 feet in the initial language, and that was too narrow. And after we had the conversation, I went, yeah, the streets are wider than 25 feet, that won't be enough. And so planning board suggested 50, and I said that sounds suitable to me. So that was the change.
And two people disagreed.
Disagreed with the change.
Any other questions from the board?
Thank you very much.
At this time, I'd like to know, is there anybody here to speak on this? So please come forward and say your name and address. Anybody to speak? If not, you are our consultant for these hours. Is there anything you need to say?
Good evening, Commissioners. Chairman Wiggins. I'm participating with Ms. Braswell. We have been the stormwater consultant for Edgecombe County for quite some time. We have participated and assisted the county to revise the new language in this proposed ordinance. The model ordinance was provided by the state of North Carolina with room for local flexibility. Edgecombe County was a little bit ahead of the curve in that you already had stormwater ordinances and requirements, a program in place ahead of the state's draft language, their draft ordinance. So our effort really took what you already had in place, modeled it within your existing program and within the state's language to come up with the draft document that you have for your consideration. I'll be glad to answer any further questions, but just wanted to make that known that you guys were in a good position going into this exercise.
Any questions?
But technically, you are following state guidance.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. This is, as I mentioned, drafted by the state, but they do allow room for local adaptation. What I mean by that is every entity within this program is going to be set up a little bit different from staff. The use of a third-party consultant, such as the Wooten Company in your particular case, there are other entities that maintain that level of review inside of staff capability. And so there are some room or some areas that allow for some of that local flexibility. But the requirements of the ordinance, things of that nature, do remain the same for the state version.
Last call. Anybody else? Mr. Evans, anybody email or questions?
Yes.
Hearing none. It's time I join the public hearing. And the planning board has followed this request with a favorable recommendation. Is there a motion to approve?
Second.
Questions? All in favor, let it be known by the voting sign. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, the motion is approved. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for us to convene as our Board of Equalization and Review. Is there a motion to recess the regular Board of Police of League and convene as a Board of Equalization and Review?
Second.
Second. Questions? All in favor, let it be known by the voting sign. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we are sitting at the Board of Equalization and Review. And I will ask our clerk to come forward and administer our oath.
If you're going to swear on the Bible, if you'll place your left hand on the Bible and raise your right hand. If you will affirm, just raise your right hand, please. Each of you do solemnly swear or affirm that you will support and maintain the Constitution and the laws of the United States and the Constitution and laws of North Carolina, not inconsistent therewith, and that you will faithfully discharge the duties of your office as member of the Board of Equalization and Review of Edgecombe County, North Carolina, and that you will not allow your actions as a member of the Board of Equalization and Review to be influenced by personal or political friendship or obligation. So help you God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam
Clerk.
You're welcome. Thank you. I think we have oaths in our package while we're thinking about lead time.
Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to call Nick Water. Please come forward and tell us what you're going to do.
Good evening, how are you guys? So tonight, I will need to, in your packets, I presented three letters that need individual action taken on them, and along with you, an updated appeals manual and an updated brochure that is mandated to be emailed with the notice of decision that any Board of Equalization review appeals that's being heard. So just a little background on the letters. The first one that you see is what I call our regular notice of decision letter. So when you guys meet, that letter is mailed out by me, which is the clerk, to the Board of Equalization and Review, to the taxpayer within the time required with the decision that you guys voted on. And it explains the rights that that person has to appeal to the Property Tax Commission and their deadlines. So if you have any questions about that letter, it says notice of decision at the top. And that needs
we need to act on that.
Yes, sir. That needs an action.
The motion would be what?
To approve the notice as presented.
Second. Questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, the notice of decision is approved.
The next notice of decision regarding discovery and compromise. The reason these letters are different is because the applicant or appellant has a possibility of appealing to the Board of Equalization Review under 105.312K, which is duties of the power to compromise. And it has a little bit of different verbiage of what you can adjust and what you can't adjust and what can be appealed. So they wanted to make that notice different compared to the regular.
This is different than this year, is that right?
That one was presented last year. That one's not. I do have a new one, but not that one.
Notice, is there a motion to approve notice of decision regarding discovery and compromise? Second. Questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed, and none. That notice is approved.
Now, the new one that is in your packet this year is notice of decision regarding an untimely real property appeal. I'm just going to read what Department of Revenue says on that. For the first time this year, we're offering an additional alternate form of the notice of decision for use only when real property appeal is filed after the board's adjournment date and only if the board conducts a hearing to determine whether the appeal was timely filed or not. The purpose of this alternate form is, one, to explain that the board cannot consider real property appeals that are filed after the adjournment date, and two, to inform the appellant that the commission will only consider the issue of timeliness in these appeals and cannot consider underlying appeal at that point. So the latest form we're offering to have the appellants who acknowledge being late in their filing with the board but are under impression that the appeal itself can still be considered by the Property Tax Commission. They believe that the appellants in these situations may reconsider whether to pursue an appeal to the PTC if they are aware of this in advance. And so basically they're saying that PTC cannot hear an untimely appeal unless for that purpose. They can only hear an appeal to PTC whether or not it is timely or not timely, not their reason for appeal. So they wanted that spelled out in their notice of decision letter. And so that's what the third letter is.
Is there a motion to
approve?
Second. So we know what we put.
Yes, sir.
Notice of decision regarding an ultimate real property. We have a second motion. Second on that question. All in favor, let me know by the vote sign. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, that notice is approved.
Thank you. And just to update, we have only had 3 appeals informally this year. And as of today's date, we have not received any appeals toward, to the Board of Equalization Review. So hopefully, at our adjournment date next month, we'll pretty much just adjourn with no changes.
That's all the business of the Board of Equalization
Review? Yes, sir.
And all the business is that must be recessed with the Board of Equalization Review until May 1, 2023, and reconvene the regular Board of Commission meeting.
Motion.
Second. Question. All in favor, let me know by the vote sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, we now set as County Commission. Thank you, sir.
Next, Mr. Chairman, you have scheduled appointments. On the agendas tonight, you have Ms. Michelle Cole and Julia Zinke, who are with the Nash Edgecombe and Wilson Community Action Agency, who will present information on their annual needs assessment and community service block grant application.
You all received a packet. In that packet was our 2023-2024. Sorry, I am having some mental
issue, so please forgive me some comments on painting. 2023-2024 application for our community service block grant. Last year, we did a community needs assessment, and in that community needs assessment, you will see that three things from the document came out very strongly, and that was that our families are lacking safe and affordable housing. Within that, there was a lot of conversation about property landlords' rights versus renters' rights. So one of the things that you did see was we're going to try to do some classes on that. We're going to use our Section 8 program with that as well. The second thing was securing job security and employment. There was a lot of parents so we're trying to build more partnerships with you. Manufacturers coming to come in town so we can have maybe a straight line to the HR department there to see if we can help with those. The third thing is affordable child care, specifically infant and toddler care. We will be working on that with our Head Start grant, trying to get some early Head Start slots in all three counties because there's a lot of child care centers who did not open back up, especially for infants and toddlers. After COVID, so we are working on that. And the last thing was not documented in the community needs assessment, but with inflation, we started receiving many calls, several calls, from senior citizens who are really being hit very hard and needing extra help with their light bill or utility bills because they're on a fixed income. So we had already rapidly, towards the end of last year, started saying that we were spending a lot of dollars on our senior citizens, so we've included that in our application as well. Are there any questions for me and Mr. Moody, our interim CSBG director, is going to talk about our outputs and our outcomes for this year, as well as our success from last year.
I have a question.
Yes,
sir. Your Section 8 housing is still effective.
Yes,
still have.
Yes, ma'am. How many units are you at?
We have 550 that we are here. We have 550. We'll be opening up our waiting list in the next probably month. We've been trying to bring our waiting list down, going back, looking at the other ones that have been since 2021. We've had a lot of openings because, unfortunately, of death with our senior citizen clients. So, and we serve Edgecombe and Nash.
Section
8. Yes,
sir. Who's the director name?
Mr. Julius Moody is our Section 8 director. Oh. We are currently hiring a CSBG director to take his place from the CSBG.
So he's going to Dr. Tour.
Is there any possibility of us getting one?
That's a great question. So one of the things that we have heard a lot is that, especially with Edgecombe County, is finding. So Mr. Moody did a couple of inspections today, and when he went, it didn't pass. So we're definitely trying to do a little bit more education with our landlords on what we're actually looking for, what actually passes for the Section 8 housing. We do have a possibility to write in for some more at the end of the year, but it's just going to depend on, you know, how federal government is.
One thing I thought about is that they're working there.
You're right, yes, sir.
I would encourage you to make that application in terms of if there's anything that we need to do to make it work there. Look difficult to meet them sometimes in terms, but I think if they understand the benefits of the program, okay, they probably would want to be a part of the program. Okay.
Yes, sir. And now that we're doing direct deposit, that has helped a lot. A lot of people just do not want paper checks anymore, and I understand that. But we also have a lot of senior citizens who are there on us who want checks. But it is, it has helped out. It has helped out a lot getting new landlords in because we are not doing our rent deposit. So hopefully we're just going to keep advertising and doing our walkthroughs.
Yeah, because we have quite a few new investors, you know, in the community that are doing some rehab work. If they know before they do that, it might help.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions or comments?
Questions.
Great.
Have you been noticing any of these landlords who are not rehabbing some of these places? I know quite a few where people are living in and the rent that they're paying. When I look at what they're living in, why is it getting on these landlords to do something to uplift these housing and apartments? I mean, I can name the streets where you go down on, but it's just a lot of them. And they have a lot of properties. But because people need somewhere to stay ASAP, they are moving in there even though those things need to be rehabbed.
Right. Next, Mr. Harris, that came out a lot, especially in our Princeville focus groups. But a lot of them also, when we asked, they were not on Section 8. But it was a lot of conversation about having to live in so poor conditions and didn't feel like they had advocacy to help. Or if they, I mean, one lady in particular talked about her grandchild falling on a hole. There was a hole outside. So that's what made us say we needed to add some education on advocacy to that. Most of our, in Section 8, it is really basic to pass. We gotta have smoke detectors. You gotta make sure you have. I mean, they give us a basic sheet. Our staff will deny them and make that they out before. Once we deny them, they have to make the corrections before we approve for that person to go into that home. And then from there, it's really a relationship between the resident and the landlord. But we do try to intervene when we think it's all that
needs to help. There's a difference sometimes between minimum code to minimum code is a CA requirement, and maybe yours is
right.
Sometimes minimum code, you're restricted sometimes, the sex act restricted sometimes, or stronger than minimum code. So how, sometimes a minimum code, you have some of those issues.
Right. And that's another thing. Let's not
take
that we do have some
tenants. It was based on, I thought they were a little worse. I'm not saying it's them doing their job.
Right.
But I didn't understand what I'm saying, okay? Okay.
We did that.
I support the program because I think it's an important program for the community. But sometimes it's a landlord.
It is definitely a balance act. And Mr. Moody can answer some of those.
I just wanted to touch briefly on the last October, North Carolina Indian Affairs and Homelessness Coalition created 500 Indian Affairs and the Homeless Coalition. They created a program that issued Nash and Edgecombe County 500 emergency housing vouchers. And we're actually getting down to our last probably 50 of those now that we have. They were distributed by the REACH Center in Rocky Mount. And the REACH Center, I think that's with Word Tabernacle Church or the Impact Center, I believe it is. But with the emergency housing vouchers, it was for individuals who were experiencing extreme homelessness or long homelessness, and individuals who would not usually get approved for housing or Section 8. So within that program, we were able to assist them with deposits, light deposits, as well as furniture as well. And in that program, any landlord who is newly joining the program can get a $500 incentive that kind of just gets them to join the program and let them know that we appreciate them for joining the program. And as Ms. Cole stated, and you stated as well, our standard or HUD standards for as far as inspections are a little bit harder to pass as far as the city standards. So we do have landlords and tenants who do get upset when they don't pass, but we have to make sure that they are up to quality HUD standards before we do pass those.
With his temporary vouchers or their permanent vouchers?
Their permanent vouchers. Yes, sir.
Do you have a problem with
it?
Sorry, something.
I went through my neighborhood, in my district, and I saw some houses that I would have seen. And I'm talking about houses boarded up or look like they needed to be boarded up. But what are we doing with those houses that are not boarded up and got people living in them and not passing standards?
So we've had a lot of, within CSBG, we've had a lot of clients express those concerns when it comes to mildew, mold, houses just not being livable, infestation with roaches, things of that nature. Only thing that we can relay or kind of get them to do is go to the Human Relations Department, report it to Human Relations, and more likely they will reach out to the landlords to try to press that matter. One thing that we will do, we will not give any money to landlords who have units like that because it's just really a waste when they don't do those repairs and just to get them up to standard.
But some of those houses or dwelling places are not livable
at all. Well, that is a local code issue in terms of if it's in Carver or it's in the city. But the city being that's not necessarily something that not need you. What's your new organization?
New.
New. Okay. The new will deal with it. That's something that code enforcement will deal with. And a lot of times when you board it up, you kind of, when you board it up, it's no longer a safety issue and it becomes a whole different issue. But those are code enforcement issues. And whether they will look for the code enforcement issue.
You got one issue. Are you having a problem finding landlords?
Over the last few months, we've been grateful to get about 10 new landlords. Just by reaching out, calling individuals, meeting private landlords, property managers. We're always looking for more, but we have been grateful to receive within this year about 10 new landlords.
So you're still looking?
We're still looking, yes, ma'am.
I guess that's my question.
Yes, we're always looking.
Okay.
We have a developer, Quartz Vision. You guys may have heard of them. They're looking to purchase a building here in Twelveboro.
Who's that?
Quartz Vision. I believe it used to be a high rise building. But they're looking to renovate it and turn it into section of property as well. So Ms. Harris is on our board, so I'll relay more information to her as we get along.
Do you have any vouchers that haven't gotten on time?
No, sir.
So there's no good for you. Give them anyway, okay? If you get your landlord, you ain't got no vouchers.
Well, we have clients who are not housed up as well, but I'd like
to. You got clients with vouchers?
Yes, sir.
That don't have houses.
Yes, sir.
How long ago that was the people in the house?
So they get 90 days, and if they don't find out within those 90 days, they get an extension on the
list.
You
give them a suit.
Yes,
after that, I can't find a house. What you could
do? The voucher is no longer in use.
Yes. If there's no housing, what is within your authority? If there's no housing available, why take the voucher?
All it requires is either they can port it to another jurisdiction or they can no longer use it.
That's only that voucher to another jurisdiction?
Yes, sir. If they have housing parties in those properties.
Any other questions? If not, thank you. They'll read the rest of it. Okay.
All right. Yeah, just wanted to give you some outcomes. Yes, sir. Give you some outcomes from last year for CSBG. So our target goal was
to start giving 2 minutes. I told you to read the rest of it. I'm going to ask you some questions. You can't answer them. Okay? You good?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you all so much.
Next, public petitions. At this time, we open public petitions. Anybody that speaks, please come forward and state your name and address.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
My name is James Wren, 704 NC 97 East, Harbor. I'm the Vice President of the Phoenix Historical Society, African American History of Edgecombe County. And first off, on behalf of our President, Major Stith, and all the members of the Phoenix Society, We want to thank the board for their continued support of our mission. Our work to recover, record, and promote the unique history of Edgecombe County as experienced by its African-American community. Now, 3 years ago, we embarked on a research project dealing with the Kingsborough Property Owners Association and the Citizens for Responsible Zoning to record the history of their effort in this county that stopped the IBP hog slaughterhouse from coming to Edgecombe County. You may have seen in the news maybe a year ago that we were fortunate to partner with East Carolina University to receive a grant to produce a 30-minute documentary on this history. And we're proud to report that the documentary is finished. We're going to premiere this documentary here in Edgecombe, Tarboro, and it's built in the Carbon Auditorium on April 22nd, which is Earth Day. This is a story of environmental justice for Edgecombe County, so it's an Earth Day story. And we're gonna pass this out there. We're gonna premiere at 11 o'clock a.m. on Saturday, April 22nd. Do you have enough? And then it'll also be premiered at East Carolina University the following Monday evening at 5:30. So we're very excited about this. Hope everybody can come out and hear this story, which their slogan in that campaign in 1995-96 is, "We can do better." And the moral of the story is, we did do better. So we think Edgecombe County is much better off without having the IBP hog slaughterhouse in Kingsborough. So, thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? You know, I can remember this. I was not on the board, and I was coming from Greenville, and I was behind a hog truck. I was wavering on where we ought to go, and I crawled behind the hog truck, and my mind was that we don't need it. And it's a very, as history shows, we have developed a great site that, thanks to the activists during that time, that has been coming, we've developed a great site for that is certainly a compliment to those involved and all of the other people that were involved at that time. I came home during that time when all of this was going on. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody speak out? Good evening. Number 127 Midway Lane, Tarboro, North Carolina. Mailing address, P.O. Box 1391, Pine Top, North Carolina. At the last meeting, you all mentioned about this board meeting with Nash County Commissioners and that kind of school board about school separation. Has those meetings been held?
They're scheduled, Mr. Anderson. They are scheduled. We've got a new schedule for our joint meeting with the April 25th for the Edgecombe County School Board and it's May 15th for the Nash County School Board.
Okay, I want to make sure I get something.
April 25th is with the Nash School Board, I believe it is. And then,
okay, and then my last thing for tonight. I've been videoing this board long before any of y'all been here, most of the meeting in Edgecombe County. And places I've been attending meetings, school board for many of you all have been on the meetings, and I try to be professional. When I came in tonight, in the room, last time I was sitting over there, today I came in here and I sit up over there because I don't like getting people from behind. And I definitely don't like to be in the back of the room. I'm 60 years old, and I try to do stuff professionally. Now, I asked the cameraman over there, I said, "Now, am I going to be in your way?" Which I said, "Well, I was not, because I don't roll like that." side. I was set up over there. The brother left the room. I'm quite sure he probably going to talk to someone. But Mr. Evans, you addressed me and asked me to move because you said people be coming through there. Again, I've been coming to this meeting. I wouldn't have been set up over there if that was the case. Now, Commissioner Harris walked through the night. That's very rare because she went to talk to the people. But still, I would not be in her way because quite a bit of room over. But what I'm getting at is I have a problem with that. Because if you, and the reason why I got a problem with it is because when this girl set up over here, he shouldn't be. When my clerk got up a while ago, she had to go out the door and come around. All she had to do was get up from her seat and come right there. So that's the problem right there. And as far as there are other people, they have said something about it a long time ago. But if I had been set up over there, that would have been no bad way. I appreciate Mr. Tolson and other folks when they walk by the camera. Now, other folks have to bend down. I don't have no problem with them walking by the camera. I'm trying to get everybody anyway. And that's very disrespectful to people because of the way the room's set up. But Mr. Evans, I got a problem with this. If you haven't wanted me to move, just tell me to move. But don't lie to me. I'm 60 years old and you're about 9 years younger than me. Just tell me, be a man.
I'm done with it. The manager controls the building.
I understand that.
In terms of what he considers, it's up to him to designate. And he, I believe he will have a force to his door in terms of where he signs people to. That is your authority. I don't know what the issue is. Okay, but the boys are all through.
No issue.
Y'all had a different real heat like that.
For the best operation of this meeting, the first purpose of this room is for this meeting and the conducting of the meeting. The video note is very important because we want to be transparent. We appreciate both of them being here because we don't have staff right now to do that for us. That's why we try to be as accommodating as we can. But ultimately, our plan is to somewhat shift these seats on this side forward so that they both can be back there. And I understand it might be rare that someone comes in, but people do come in on both sides. Last month, he was on the other side. It was right behind. It was Mungo right in front of Mike and Natalie. On this side, people do come in. Now, that is the plan. That's where we're going to have both of them sit in the back of the room. We will have better sound as soon as the equipment comes in. That will help them better pick up sound. But that's the plan. If the board wants me to do anything different.
Well, I think it appears that there's some thought to that, and staff is moving to make sure that you accommodate. Okay? And accommodation will be there. We appreciate, we're open, and appreciate you. Anybody else, we're going to accommodate the public in terms of being here. And so continue to work on that.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Was there any public petition via email?
No, sir.
Hearing none, is there anybody else to speak at public petition? Hearing none, moving on to other business. Consideration of amendments. Go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. You'll see in your agenda package you have a number of budget amendments that are for your approval. The rest are for your awareness. I do want to point out, beginning at budget amendment number one, this budget amendment is being brought to you. You'll see that we are receiving additional revenue, register of deeds office, the amount of $120,000, so we are appropriating that additional revenue. Also want to point out two budget amendments, number 8 and 9. Number 8 is related to, as you know, we are preparing to do some renovations to the health department office in Rocky Mount. That work has been bid out. Low bids have come in, and so they are higher than what we initially anticipated that cost to be. So I'm recommending a budget amendment here total amount of $80,710. I do ask that you hold that budget amendment to go along with the approval of the contract itself. I'll refer back to that. That's number eight, yes, sir. Budget amendment number nine is to increase funds in other professional services in the manager's budget line. This is to accommodate recommendation to approve a contract for state lobbying services. I will ask that you hold that budget amendment until later in the agenda when we talk about that contract. So at this time, I'm asking that you approve budget amendments numbers 1 through 7.
I ask for any questions on any of the budget amendments before we get a motion. Any questions? If not, is there a motion to approve budget amendments 1 through 7?
Yes, sir.
Second.
Next is regarding amendment to our personnel policy. Currently, our personnel policy recognizes having employees on standby or on-call status. These team members are paid 8 hours each week that they are on call. If the employee must come into work while on call, they are then also paid the actual hours that they work. Policy currently states the pay for actual work begins when the employee arrives at the work site. However, as written, it does not recognize that some on-call employees can respond remotely to the work that is needed. Therefore, I propose the addition of the language shown in red in the attached excerpt of our personnel policy, whereby pay for actual work for on-call employees working remotely will begin when they engage in that work. They're already going to get paid 8 hours just for being on call. And then they actually have to do something. It only takes them 15 minutes. They're already getting paid for that 8 hours, then they're getting paid for 15 in addition.
Well, I guess that's my question. How do we verify if somebody works off site? Do they come in the timesheet?
Yes, they note that on their timesheet. Okay. Yes.
So we have a way of tracking what they're doing and what and how long.
That's right. We have a column on our timesheet for on-call pay, and their supervisor has to approve that.
But they're paid 8 hours just for being on call. Just they respond. Either.
That's right, because they have to be around. They have to pay themselves.
Is that the policy of most people?
That's generally how on-call pay works, yes, sir. So we do that. IT, maintenance, utilities department, the three that come to mind right now, that they are paid those 8 hours for making themselves.
So if I call a war man out on stage and wanted to do something, he's paid for 8 hours plus whatever time he's speaking.
That's correct. Yes.
We pay for 15 minutes.
We pay 15 minutes.
And you get 8 hours right off the bat then?
I'm saying.
They have to report that to their supervisor, and the supervisor approves that on their time.
But somebody got to call them in. That's right. I mean, if somebody's documentation for the need, if somebody, if something goes down, somebody calls them in. Okay. So.
Certain people, especially the things that are on call, already know that they're on call.
That's right.
In case something happens. You know, we're on call.
I got a motion.
Yeah, second.
Any more questions? All in favor, let me know by the roadside. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, just approved. Go ahead.
Item C, which is the resolution regarding City of Rocky Mount funding request for the new Judicial Center. I received information from City staff earlier today that they've asked us to remove this from consideration tonight. So we ask that you take no action on this tonight. Yeah, I'm assuming they are reconsidering.
Okay.
item D is regarding easement agreement. Ms. Paula Collins owns property adjacent to a parcel the county acquired through FEMA buyout program following Hurricane Floyd. Ms. Collins is requesting an access easement across the property. This is a reasonable request, and approving an easement would not violate the restrictive covenants placed on the property per the buyout program. Therefore, I recommend that you approve the enclosed easement agreement as presented.
Motion.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Questions?
Got a question again.
Go ahead, ask.
I read this and I'm just trying to follow along. I'm just real curious why she needs it. I'm looking at the pictures. I'm trying to figure out the type of questions.
Ms. Collins, as you saw at the second map, owns that property that's landlocked. The only path is that path that borders, it goes along the border of the county's property as far to the east of it. Far under to the east, and Ms. Collins, he's not getting that much.
Okay.
She needs access to the lot.
So there was an easement.
Well, there was no easement. There was a.
He was just an allowance.
Okay.
And that would provide her with the easement.
We could have given a lease, a dollar a year, he spent a lot of good.
Well,
crap. Yeah, we could have given a lease, huh?
Actually, it was already being leased.
Okay, that's why. Okay, she had her own lot, okay.
I'm just trying to.
What's on the lot?
It just comes up.
It's an empty.
Somebody leasing it.
It's not as wide as any of
the lot. Well, we usually lease these lots about a dollar a year, though.
Yes, sir. We do, not always. But.
Okay.
We do. It's just that property, that particular property, is being leased now. So she wouldn't be able to lease it.
Can I ask you, what's happening on that lot?
Nothing. They're meant to remain empty lots, no structures.
So the farmer leases the lot? Well, that's all right. I don't go ahead.
They're at least cutting grass.
Don't.
Do they live, the ones that are leasing, do they live next to them?
No. I think he lives, the farmer lives in.
Okay, so at least about to keep over. Go ahead. Okay, we got it straight.
As long as they don't build anything.
If no lease, she needs to lease it. We need to go back and let her lease it.
I think we're just setting a precedent that we'll have to do this in any situation.
The one difference here from a typical county property, this is the county doesn't use, and
we can't
park, can't
use. And we can't put anything on it anyway.
Gotcha.
Okay.
That's why we low risk.
That's why I was asking. Any other questions? All in favor? Do you like the motion?
Yes.
All in favor, let me know by the left side of the eye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, is approved. Next.
Item E. The Edgecombe County ABC Board is requesting land from the county for the purpose of constructing a new warehouse. They are interested in an acre of the parcel the county owns at the corner of Anaconda and McNair Road. The board is open to considering this request. I recommend that you allow us to determine the best portion of that parcel to locate the warehouse, which currently totals 33 acres, and have the lot surveyed and bring it back for your consideration. I do want to note, I forgot to put it in my memo, that this same lot on one side of it is where we're planning to build the new animal shelter. So both purposes can fit this lot, but if you're open to this, we ask that you at least give direct me to have a survey for us to determine the best place to locate it, have it surveyed, and bring that back for your final approval.
Motion.
Okay, I'll make that motion.
Second. Yes, sir. Questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote sign.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, is approved. Next.
Next is regarding JCPC funding for next fiscal year. The Department of Public Safety is again making available funds for the juvenile crime prevention programs for FY24 in the amount of $255,122 to provide services to court-involved and at-risk youth. The Juvenile Crime Prevention Council at their last meeting voted to recommend funding per the attached spreadsheet. I recommend the board approve the allocation of these funds as presented, including $25,512 in local match, to be included in the FY24 budget and to authorize me to execute agreements with each state.
Second. questions? All in favor, let it be known by the vote of a aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, it is approved.
Item G. We previously adopted resolutions to authorize the submission of applications for grant funding available in the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality. Two of the projects were not awarded in the first two rounds, but are eligible to be resubmitted. Therefore, I recommend that you adopt the enclosed resolutions as presented.
Motion.
Second.
Questions? All in favor, let it be known by the vote of
a aye. Aye.
All opposed?
You have in your agenda packet a resolution to honor Coach Tanisha Lewis, who is the women's basketball coach for Elizabeth City State University. She is a native of Edgecombe County. I believe she was born in Macclesfield and has brought to our attention. I think it's quite an accomplishment for her. I'll be happy to read the resolution for her.
Coach Tanisha Lewis, Elizabeth City State University women's basketball coach, resolution to honor. Whereas the members of Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners believe that all our citizens contribute to the greatness of our county, yet there are some whose service and achievements are notable and worthy of our recognition. Whereas Ms. Tanisha Lewis is a native of Edgecombe County, is one such citizen deserving of our honor for her exemplary leadership and commitment. And whereas after graduating from Southwest Edgecombe High School, Coach Lewis went on to play for North Carolina State University and then played for a number of years in the Women's National Basketball Association. And whereas Ms. Lewis is the Elizabeth City State University women's basketball coach, recently led her team to the first CIAA championship title. Now, therefore, be it officially and publicly noted that the Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners hereby gives honor to the leadership and achievements of Coach Tanisha Lewis this third day of April, 2023, assigned by our chairman, Leonard Wiggins, attested for Angie Young to our court.
And that is a motion.
Yes, sir.
Second.
I second.
Questions?
It's not a question, but if you would, that last whereas, it says Rick has been led for team, is correct, spelling up the
okay. I think it can be set up spelled either way, L-E-A-D or L-E-D.
May I just say
the motion is for whichever way is correct. Whichever way is correct. Any other questions? All in favor, let it be known by the vote of a aye.
Aye.
Be led. Whichever
way. Let me just put it this way.
It is so approved.
Tanisha is a leader.
Okay.
In every respect.
Okay.
From the time that I've known her in high school, I'm blessed to have known her parents, blessed to have known her grandmother, and blessed to see her play at NC State University, as many of you are. And, you know, all these wrestlers that we look at from years past, something like that, a total package. But Tanisha is. Absolutely. The total package. In every respect.
Yeah,
you want me to go ahead and say it? The town of Macclesfield is honoring Tanisha on the 8th, which is next Saturday. And certainly everybody here is invited to that wonderful event in our small town. Love to see you there.
Any other comments or questions? Hearing none. Moving on to next.
Due to overcrowding in their facility, the Halifax County Sheriff, Mr. Tyree Davis, has requested Sheriff Atkinson to consider the attached agreement to house inmates. Sheriff Atkinson has agreed, and therefore the attached interlocal agreement is presented for your consideration. I recommend that you approve the interlocal agreement with Halifax County for the transfer, detention, and care of inmates as presented.
Motion.
Chair
moves. Second.
For inmate, county to county, federal inmates.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Hearing none, it is approved. Madam Clerk, what message would you like? We have no recommendation?
No, sir.
Hearing none, moving on to Alpha Lease and Vista releases for review and approval. Anything that we're going to call attention to, Mr. Chairman?
No, sir. Have to answer any questions that you might need.
Motion to approve? Yeah, motion to approve.
Question?
All in favor, let it be known by a vote of sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, it is approved. Next, Mr. Chairman.
Next, you have in your packet a list of contracts for your consideration. This is a little busy, so I ask if you would to take action on each of these separately. So the first one is vendor's Long's Home Repair. Contract amount is $68,000. This is for cleaning and painting one pod in the detention center. Funding is already budgeted in our current CIP, and it is within the budget that we have set aside. This will be managed by our maintenance department. I recommend that you approve that contract as presented.
Do you have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Question?
Please say.
Questions? All in favor, let it be known by a vote of sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, it is approved. Okay.
The second one is for Small Town Landscaping LLC. This is, you'll recall last two years prior, we had bundled all of our grass cutting from our buildings, properties that we own, from utilities, properties we acquired to buy out and tax foreclosure. We had bundled all of that together. It was just such a difficult, big contract to manage. So this year we have broken that back up. You've already approved one contract for grass cutting and lawn maintenance. We added that to for our buildings. This is grass cutting and lawn maintenance for off-site county properties that are managed by the utilities department in an amount of $55,120. We did bid this out. I think we got three or four bids. This is the lowest responsive bidder. I recommend that you approve that, and we do have that budget.
So,
thank you.
Question?
The third one is with KTS Strategies LLC. This is for state lobbying services. You recall at your last meeting, I shared with you the proposals, or list of proposals that we received. We interviewed three of those firms. Commissioner Thorne joined me and staff to review those proposals and interview three of those firms. We're recommending tonight this company, KTS Strategies LLC. It seems to be quite capable and have the capacity that we need to do this. You'll see it is for a contract price not to exceed $82,000. This is for a year contract. Accompanying this is budget amendment number 9, which you saw earlier in the agenda packet, wherein I'm requesting that those additional funds to be added to professional services to cover us for the rest of this fiscal year. I recommend that you approve the contract as well as budget amendment number 9.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Questions?
Go ahead.
Now, is this company, do we know what they are lobbying for other counties?
They are a large, relatively large firm. Many staff, I think there were 5 or 6 of their team members that were in the interview that we did. They have staff that specialize, if you will, on both sides of the aisle. And they have, based on the proposal and the interview, have a proven track record of being white cap.
And did we set any expectations that we expected?
Well, we specified in the request for proposal the areas in which we want them to focus. Things like economic development, education, things like that. We didn't put any performance measures like you have to bring in X millions of dollars in funding, that kind of thing. But, you know, obviously we will review their performance to determine how effective we think that they are.
And I read the contract, it promised it.
That's right. And none of them.
In our interview process, we spoke of specific items that we already identified that we were looking at, and they felt that they responded well to us as it is on them to give them a direction to go. So I think it's on us to say, these are the needs that we have. Can you go find them for us?
Yeah.
And empower them to go to work.
Any other questions? I didn't get a motion. Get a motion. Any other questions? All in favor, let me know by the vote, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, there's a motion for the budget amendment and the contract.
The next one is a contract with James Building Group LLC, amount of $209,210. As I mentioned earlier, this contract is for renovations, including asbestos remediation at the health department and our Rocky Mount campus. Included with this recommendation is budget amendment number 8, which would be requesting the appropriation of an additional $80,710. This will be managed in our maintenance department. I recommend that you approve.
Second. Just a second. Question?
How long have they been out of that building?
About a year and a half now. We've had some reduced services there. We had COVID clinic on Friday there. But being fully operational there for about almost 2 years.
So, their balance. If they've been able to be out that long, what really, really needed?
The balance is the people in the area need service. We have an underserved. We have an underserved. The balance is to put the service back in the community. That was there. And in talking with the manager, I think it's talking about additional services that might be added to that community.
I don't feel that it's fair to say that you haven't been served, because we have a whole staff that's serving you.
We have not been properly served. Maybe I've changed it. We have not been served in the amount that we previously served. So I think it's fair to say that the people that community would have previously been able to walk and don't have the necessary transportation need the services.
I appreciate your correction there, because that staff works hard to serve the people of the county, and I want to make sure that we recognize that
they are greatly recognized.
Yeah.
They are great to recognize in terms of, I recognize if that came out that way, I apologize, okay? But I have no staff that I don't support in this kind of thing. My advocacy in this county, even when it comes to pay raises, benefit is for all of the employees, okay? I offer an apology if that was taken by any of the staff out there in terms of the business. This is from Micah, how it came out. So.
Is there a plan to get to staff that building back to the current level? If we spend this money, is there a plan to staff that building? Is there staff to staff it?
Yeah, so the plan is that we are going to have health department services back there. We're going to have clinic there at least one day a week, possibly 2 days a week. Now, we won't be able to have clinic at both places at the same time, likely because of limited staff. But we're also going to have a presence of some of our other services in that building, to include aging services, veteran services, partnering with other outside agencies that we partner with to provide services, giving them access to the building. So, so the goal there, and particularly in the critical service we provide in the health department, is to make access to that as easy as possible. And so over 50% of the county's population lives inside the city limits of Rocky Mount. So I recommend, and I think this is a good move for us to have a presence in Rocky Mount.
Hearing none, all in favor of the motion, let me know by the vote, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, is approved.
And the last one is with TA Loving Company in the amount of $6 million. And by the way, you'll see at your place there's a bid sheet, looks like this, that's your company at the top left. So the bids just came in on Friday. consultants with the Loop Company reviewed those bids, provided this, to see that this is the lowest responsive bidder, TA Loving, in the amount of $6,613,067.50. This is for wastewater system improvements in District 6, that is down in Princeville. As I mentioned, bids were open on Friday. The recommendation is to approve this contract in this amount to TA Loving, and that it be contingent upon approval of the USDA and the local government commission. Part of the funding source of this is part grant, part loan. So we do have to go before the LGC to get approval for the loan. So the recommendation is to approve this contingent upon approval of USDA and the local government commission.
Can I get that motion?
Motion.
This is primarily rehab, renovation of the sewer system. A lot of that sewer needs to be, as old needs to be replaced. A lot of groundwater infiltration is coming into that system. It will not bring down water bills. Oh, yes.
And
it's
just the dollars. It's our system.
That's the sewer's principle. That's correct. Michael reminded me. Also included with that, I recommend you'll see at your place there is a revised budget ordinance, project ordinance. You originally approved this project ordinance some time back. We are making changes within the budget lines. You'll see that the total funding amount does not change, but we're making changes within budget lines. There's a copy of the previously adopted ordinance behind that. So the recommendation is to approve this contract and amend the project ordinance contingent upon approval of the of USDA and local government.
Do I get that motion?
Are we less than Vic came in at $6.6 million and we are approved for $7 million. So we are coming in under budget.
Or the rest of that are engineering costs pre.
Are we going to have to adjust that, do you think? In conversation, I've heard that the bids came in higher than we expected. So are we expecting some kind of capital cost adjustment?
Some of those ancillary costs could be adjusted. The overall project amounts will be the same. But that's why you see some of the adjustments between some of those lines.
It appears that the equipment went up, the construction, the engineering fees, those things, you know, it's just coming.
Yeah, but if we thought that the bid came in high, how are they changing? Are they just lowering engineering costs?
Mike, you want to come up after?
Yeah.
So if you look at the big sheet here, if you look at all of the ad alternates, we'll Clarkson's here, we can come in as well. He and I have had several different discussions about this over the past probably 2 months or so, along with the USDA. They've been involved in this whole project from start to finish. When this project was originally funded back in 2017, the numbers that we had at $7 million would cover the entire project. Unfortunately, you know what has happened to price of materials since then. Actually, if we were to do the entire project now, just the construction side, it would be around $10 million, just a little over $10 million. So that's why you'll see the ad alternates A, B, C, D, and E, because we were looking at the project. We decided that, you know, if we don't do these as ad alternates, there's no way we'll ever be able to because of USDA, actually, they just came out with bottle rules, Buy America, Build American Act. This project was not subject to that. However, if we had requested subsequent funding to do this whole project, the whole project would have been subject to the bottle rules. And that would have drove the cost of this project even higher than what it already is. So we decided to take a step back and say, okay, let's add all these out as ad alternates. Let's put them in as ad alternates. Let's just do a what can we get away with, what we think we can get away with, and get done with this amount of money. Obviously, we only had $5.6 million originally for construction. I think that was within the original budget. The base bid come back at 6.6, but since Friday, we have reduced the project scope even more to bring it within budget of what we can afford to do with what funding we have, which brings it to the 5.9. With the 5.9 million, we had to restructure some of the costs of the project, which is where you see the change in the budget ordinance, or the amendment to the budget ordinance, so that we can get to that 5.9 million. Still get a decent sized project completed. What we're going to do from this point is take the remainder of this project and bundle that as a new project and go to USDA for more funding. That was the only way we could do it without having to be kind of, I'm going to call it bombarded with the bottlenecks. I mean, if we had done that, if 10 million would have come close, it might could have been 7, probably, I'm going to say 14, 15 million, it would have been a significant.
So I guess my question there is, we have $7 million from USDA. Those add alternates to $4.5 million on top of the 6.6 that we're doing. What are we losing from our initial vote? Where is the $4.5 million being lost? Like what are we not doing that we said that we weren't?
So one of them is a lift station, and we'll feel free to correct if I'm wrong. In fact, I'll tell you what, rather than me standing up here and rambling, I'll let Will tell you what the ad options are, because he can get much better.
So, very good question. As Mike was describing, the original project was funded back in 2017. At that time, what we have shown as the base bid represented the entirety of that project at that time. Over the course of the project, USDA approached the county with the opportunity to restructure the project. The loan to grant ratio improved while we were during the permitting, or right before the permitting, the technical design permitting phase. With that restructuring of the grant to loan percentage, the county was able to increase the overall amount of funding. This added roughly $1.3 million, which led us to the $7 million total. At that time, because of where we were in the design phase, it was easier for us, again, in 17, 18, to add these as add alternates, still representing the entirety of the project. Fast forward to 2023, after many delays, many hurdles, this project actually got to bid. With the significant increases in costs, this worked to the county's favor in that we could bid the project and get competitive bid pricing for the add alternates on the off chance that the overall construction budget fell within the money in hand. What these add alternates represent are additional areas within the District 6 system that include sewer rehabilitation or sewer replacement. That is at alternates A, B, C, and E. At alternate D represents the one pump station that was also broken out as an at alternate. So many of those work type items are very similar to what is included in the base bid. It's just a smaller version of what is in the base bid. As Mike was describing with the BABA requirements, the primary goal in getting this project into bid was making sure that we achieve the items within the overall scope that are most sensitive to the limitations of BABA. What I mean by that is, with the federal BABA requirements, there are very sensitive construction items such as pumps, generators, control panels, backup, electrical equipment, that if BABA is in fact enacted, up to 90% of the available equipment on the market is ineligible. That was Mike's point about if we were to enact BABA on this exact scope, this project may or may not have even been feasible to bid out, just for lack of materials and work. And so the goal for this was to achieve the most that we could without stepping over that BABA triggering point. And so within this base bid scope, we do have a priority on the sewer pump stations, as well as the most critical I&I points, to Mr. Evans' point. So that is removing stormwater, removing groundwater from the system. And so we are still able to achieve that goal. Six of the seven pump stations will see a complete overhaul, and we are addressing the most critical deficiencies within the system to get that I&I out of the system.
So we're doing preliminary work in anticipation that we expect the USDA to make some adjustment or to offer an additional amount to finish the alternates?
So, like Mike was saying, the goal from this point moving forward is the ad alternate that county does not have USDA funding for at this moment. The goal would be to take those, repackage them into a future USDA application. All of the preliminary work has been done, the engineering work has been done, and so we would very easily be able to repackage that into a new USDA application.
And I think it's important to know that, let's just say we're not able to get funding for those ad alternate items, the work that we're doing with the funding that we have can stand alone and will be a significant improvement to the system.
And the water grants that the governor's going around awarding now, Princeville is not eligible for that because of population, is that correct?
Well, I think some of those infrastructure grants, particularly those that are funded with money coming down from our federal ARPA funds, make its way, we could possibly get funded.
So this is doing that work to go ahead and help. If that were to happen, it's already in place.
Yes. Any other
questions?
Mr. Chairman, if I could, just to clean up the motion that we requested a little bit. If first you would consider, and I recommend that you approve the amended grant project ordinance as presented.
Is there a motion?
Yes.
Second.
Second.
Question. All in favor, let me know by the aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, yes, approved.
And secondly, I recommend that you approve the contract with TA Loving in the amount of $6,613,067.50, contingent upon approval by USDA and the local government.
It's not this, it's the, we had to take it here, it's actually approved.
Okay,
it's
5.9. The proposed reduced bid amount, so what you have represented on the large page, we have to certify the bids as received at the time of bid. Post-bid, since Friday, we've been working with the representative from TA Loving to do a bid modification. As they are the lowest responsive, responsible bidder, we can work directly one-on-one with them in that capacity on behalf of the county. And what we have proposed is this bid modification. So in the letter of recommendation, as well as the notice of award, the revised amount additional, and that is in the amount of $5,918,826.25.
That was the motion.
Yes.
It's on this. That's the amount that's on there for construction.
Recommend that the board approves the contract with TA Loving in the amount of four stated, contingent upon approval from the USDA and local government.
Is there a motion?
Motion.
Second. Question. All in favor, let me know by the vote. Sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, it is approved. And I think what I heard is staff has been done. Trying to get the best use of the federal grant money to move forward this project. Okay, in terms of working with our consultants. And explain some things to us that it's hard to understand itself for having the background to really deal with this. Thank you for that. Okay. Any other comments or questions? That's all the contract for service.
Yes, sir.
Department of reports, or if you want a sewer update, any questions on the board? Want the finance statement, any questions on the board? Solid waste report, any questions on the board? Here none, who knows matters, just go ahead.
You have in your packet workforce development indicators as well as, excuse me, the monthly TDA financial report. Also, I want to just give you a brief follow-up. As you'll recall, at your retreat a few weeks ago, we had a very, I think, robust and productive discussion talking about budgeting, but also looking at talking about the vision of the county, where we're going. We described it as, you know, considering where we are, where we want to go as a county, both from the perspective of our citizens as well as the perspective of us as an organization. So it's like an internal vision as well as an external vision. And then considering what do we need to do to get from where we are to where we want to go. So you all provided some really good feedback that we captured. You voted on your responses. We narrowed down to those that seem to be priority for you. And then I took that same information, same approach to our department heads. We had a vision casting session, if you will, a couple of weeks ago. Looked at the same question. What's the vision for the county? What's the vision for our organization? We talked about some value statements that you did as well. So you'll see in your agenda packet those information that share side by side your responses as well as responses from our department head. And I think you'll see a lot of overlap, and that's good because we're thinking in similar terms and looking in similar directions. At your retreat, we talked about having a call to action and borrowing from Mr. Carman, our former county manager, who used to say, he used to remind us often, as how sick and tired he was of us being at the top and bottom of every bad list, and we need to do something about that. So we've condensed that sentiment from him. I've internalized that. We've internalized that as an organization, and we've reduced that to our call of action, which we said, get off the list. So you have a copy of signed. I gave a copy of all our department heads. I have this above my door in my office to remind us that this is the long-term work that we're doing. You'll hear this phrase from us often, particularly when we sit down and start looking at our budget for next year and upcoming years. And then you'll see also in your agenda packet, what I asked our department heads to do was to take those responses that you all provided when we looked at the vision for the county and for our organization. They also provided their own responses separately without even having seen you all. And we took those, and then I separated them into groups, two different groups, and then they fashioned those into draft vision statements, complementary vision statements, one vision for the county, one vision for our organization. So you'll see two sets of proposed vision statements from those two groups. The next step is to take all of that work, and the executive team and I are going to work on this week, taking that and fashioning, sort of blending that to have one set of vision statement from the county, vision statement for our organization, and I'll bring that back to you for you to see. And that's important. I mean, we're spending a lot of time and effort on this, but it's important because this is what is to guide the work that we do for the next however many years to come. Also provided in there, you'll see a new logo for the county. Our Parks and Rec Advisory Board have been doing really good work. They met at one of their couple of last meetings, and one of the things they talked about, they said,
They said, well, we need a look. We need to come together to identify ourselves, Edgecombe County Parks and Recreation. And so they had some samples that were mocked up. They voted on that, and it looks very similar to the one that I have. And I went to that meeting. I said, I like that. I said, I think we can take that and adopt that as the new logo for the county. And certainly, we still have our county seal. That will always be the official seal of Edgecombe County. But I think having a logo that somewhat rebrands this effort, this new energy that we're trying to take on, of getting us from where we are to where we want to go. I have a copy of that. You'll see those 10 stars above the logo. They represent our 10 municipalities. Our municipalities are critical partners of ours. They provide critical services to a number of many of our citizens, so I think that's important. So, not requesting any action from you tonight, just wanted you to be aware of where we've gone since we last discussed some of these things at your retreat and where we're going to be yet.
Like that?
I do.
I like that.
Any questions or concerns? If not, at this time, anything of any commission?
Last week I went to our risk management district meeting, and they too are rebranding, and we'll have a new logo coming out. But also this past Thursday, I was on the North Carolina Association of County DSS Association Board, of which I am now the District 11 Director. Edgecombe, Nash, Wage, Wilson, Martin County. And our guest speaker was Shanice Ransom, who is the executive director of the North Carolina Association of DSS. And one of the main things she talked about at great length was, although Medicaid expansion has been signed off on by the General Assembly and the governor, well, it's not the thing that's going to happen tomorrow. Number one, it can't happen until the actual budget is done. And then even after the budget is done, if it's passed July 1st, it's still going to be several months, maybe even a year, before Medicaid expansion can really go into effect. Some of the main reasons are because everybody on Medicaid has to be recertified. Every county in North Carolina is having problems with having enough staff to even recertify the regular folks. But over time, during the pandemic, additional people were put on Medicaid. We're all those folks have to be recertified. It's going to be a momentous job for every DSS in the state, and especially for ours since we really are down stacks. But she wanted to make sure that everybody's getting calls locally on state level to let them know it is not going to happen tomorrow. We appreciate the 5 years of our association asking the General Assembly to take a look at it, that they have finally passed it. But our citizens, those 600,000 people who still need insurance, it won't happen tomorrow. So if anybody should call you before they start calling me, to let them know. And there's nothing that we can do about it until everybody has been recertified.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we can go out into closed session to discuss the economic development matter and personnel. So, all in favor, let me know by vote. I mean, get a motion.
Second.
Questions? All in favor, let me know by voting. Aye. All opposed? And now, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming.
Thank you. Like,